Save the World's artwork from The White Hand in the Art Project, a fantastic cooperative board game from The Op, who we have to thank for hooking us up with a review copy.
Now, The Art Project, that's spelled A.R.T. project, comes from designers Florian Sirix and Benoit Turpin, and was originally published by Lumberjack Studio, which is an indie publisher from the Normandy region of France. It has been localized for North America by The Op, or USAopoly.
This cooperative game can be played with 1 to 6 players, but we found that there's a really sweet spot at 3 players. Games are surprisingly quick, with our 3-player games taking only about 45 minutes tops.
There are quite a few moving parts in the art project, so the AgeMac recommendation of 12 plus seems about right.
Yep. So in the art project, you are part of an art rescue team, the art rescue team. That's where the A.R.T. comes from. It's a ragtag group trying to rescue the world's artwork from the evil White Hand. You'll travel the world from U.S. to Japan and even the Polynesian islands, working together to find clues and recover crates of stolen artwork, battling the White Hand together with a team of allies. This cooperative game has players using cards to collect clues, move around the map, manage resources, and battle the White Hand with a simple D6 dice pool mechanic. Can you recover all of the artwork before you run out of time or the White Hand takes over too many cities?
And we cannot not mention this. One of the most impressive things about this game is the Vincent Dutrait artwork, which you can see throughout our The Art Project unboxing video over on YouTube.
And it's not just the artwork that's great here. The iconography is fantastic. The card design is super functional, and the wooden resource and White Hand tokens are all uniquely shaped and colored. Honestly, some of the production quality in this game is the best we've seen.
You start the game by picking 1 of the 6 maps to play, each which offers a unique challenge. Each map has its own section of the rule book that you'll use to set it up. This includes giving you a starting city and placing a bunch of White Hand tokens on the cities on the map.
Each player chooses a character and takes a matching character card, D6 die, 3 health tokens, and places their playing piece onto the starting city. You load up the van with 3 of each resource. There's guns, fuel, and walkie-talkies. The clue deck gets set up, which involves inserting an end of the game card towards the bottom part of the deck, and you're ready to go.
Each turn, players will draw 2 cards from the clue deck in any order. You can see the city icons on the backs of each card, which may influence who you want to get what card.
Players look at their 2 cards and choose 1 to play. Now, each card has 3 parts. The first is the cost to play the card. These come from the 3 resources. If at any time a player wants or needs to spend a resource they don't have, they can spend a heart. They call this the golden rule because it comes up a lot.
The next part of the card shows city icons. For each of those, you will place a white hand onto the appropriate spot on the map.
Finally, there is the reward section to let you know what resources you're going to gain, which can include any of the 3 resources or hearts. Note, some cards only have 2 or 3 of these things on them. There are cards with no cost, cards with no cities.
Each card also has 1 or 2 clue icons on it. This is on both the front and the back of the cards. After everyone's played their cards, you're going to look at all the face-up cards on the table, and if you have 3 matching icons, you must place an art crate on the matching city.
Once everyone has played cards, players can move their pawns on the map. Cities are connected by lines on the map, and in general, moving from one city to a connected city costs 1 fuel, but this changes up depending on the map that you're on.
After everyone has moved, you resolve each city in the order you choose. If a player is with a crate and there are no white hands there, they take the crate. You win by collecting 7 crates. If there are white hands present, you must battle them.
Now, battling is dead simple. Each player present rolls their D6 die, and you're trying to get a total that's based on how many white hand tokens are in the city, plus a number based on how many crates your team has collected. The more crates you've collected, the tougher the white hand fights back. Now, guns can be spent, add 2 to your total, and dice can be rerolled by spending clue cards that have already been played.
You can get additional help by calling in allies. These are black D6 dice that can be used by any player, and you earn them by spending walkie-talkies. At the start of the game, these additional dice will cost 6 walkie-talkies, but then the price goes down as you collect more crates and more people join your cause.
If you win the combat, all white hand from that city are removed from the board, and you collect any crate that they were guarding. If you fail, the active player loses a heart.
Now, the player loses if any of them run out of hearts. You also lose if 4 cities fall to the white hand. At the end of each round, you check the board to see if any cities have been overrun, which happens if they have five or more white hand tokens on them. Once a city is taken, you can't move into it or move through it. Plus, any new white hand that would be placed there instead go on a special spot on the board and add to the strength of all white hand everywhere on the board, making all fights more difficult.
The game includes four difficulty levels, which just change how many hearts you start with, from easy with four to they did not know it was impossible, so they did it, with only one heart for each player.
In addition to these overall rules, each map has its own idiosyncrasies. For example, on the Egypt map, moving down the Nile is free, but moving up costs fuel, and all the cities are in a straight line. So losing one to the white hand can be devastating. It only costs one fuel to get anywhere in the Polynesian Islands, but there are two cities for each icon, and the white hand shows up at both when a clue card is played. Scandinavian cities give you a bonus or a boon when collecting crates from each city, and feature some routes that cost two fuel.
So the most striking thing about the art project is the art. Like, this game looks fantastic. Sean said it earlier. This has one of the best production qualities from a board game we've ever seen. And this isn't like some Kickstarter game with a bunch of stretch goals and upgrades and a deluxe edition. This is just what the retail version looks like. It includes little touches. Like, there's actually a postcard from the white hand sitting posing on a beach with some artwork. And there's like a poster inside. And the game has fantastic card design.
Yeah, it's just gorgeous. The quality is really high and it's very cohesive. Like, everything just goes together and looks like it belongs together. But each map has its own theming and its own, while still feeling cohesive to the game. It's just beautifully well produced, and the iconography and everything is so simple and easy to read. It's just gorgeous to look at.
Yeah, it's really remarkable. Now, I guess that's to be expected from a game called Art Project, but I've seen games about art where the only attractive thing was the masterpieces of art they used in it. So it's not even a given that something called Art Project is going to be as beautiful as this game.
Now, the next thing is how much stuff you get in this box. Like, honestly, this game would be totally sellable, viable, and people would buy it if it came with one map. Having a two-sided map, of course, makes sense. You're going to put the board in. Why not put one on each side? But I would have been perfectly happy with that. But you don't just get two. You get three double-sided maps, each with its own special rules. Six total maps. Six new ways to play the game. That's the kind of thing that I expect to be separate expansions. Like, I would have had to go out and buy Map Pack 2, Polynesian Islands and Egypt. Right? But you get it all in one box, which is fantastic value.
Yeah, I was surprised by the second map and then shocked by the third one. And I mean, the third double-sided map, right? And each one is so unique and has such a unique look to it, unique theming, and unique rules, which it just makes for so many varied experiences in that one tiny box.
Now, as a result of all this content in the box, I somewhat doubt that there will be expansions for this. Yeah. But given the game mechanics available, I can't see any reason why fans wouldn't be able to whip up their own maps if they ever did finally grow tired of the six included options.
I'll admit, I actually feel bad we didn't look that up with today's show topic that goes with this review. I bet you there are fan maps out there, and if there aren't, I'd be surprised. And as Deanna said, the great thing is that each map has its own rules, which makes the game much enjoyable because everyone feels different. Because as a cooperative game, like many cooperative games, this game is very much a puzzle, right? You're trying to solve the puzzle, and there are some random elements. And while each map presents a different version of that puzzle, while the overall mechanics are the same, what we described above applies to all the maps, each gives you a very different feel.
Because the game plays relatively quickly, I really love that we can sit down and go through a couple maps with a couple different feel, a different flavor, all in one sitting, right? It's like, oh, we beat this one. Okay, let's go try this one. All right, well, we came close. Let's do this one a second time. All right, now let's move on to a third map. You know, like, I like that. Not that one is necessarily harder than the other. They're just different.
Yeah, they aren't huge changes, but given how tough the game is, you don't need a big change to really shift the balance. The fact that they did manage to balance the six maps is impressive enough.
Overall, I like the mechanics here. Like, they're just solid mechanics. And what I like is this is a cooperative game that tends to lead to group discussion and not quarterbacking. Your main thing this happens in is that planning phase. It's the phase where everyone's got their cards, but they have to decide which to play. And some of this, like, there's some fascinating things going on there, because every card has a cost in resources, and where you're placing the white hand is also important, and resources are tight. So the order you play your cards in can be huge, as you often won't have the resources you need. And often, like, one of the players will be here going, you know, I can't play any of the cards in my hand without spending a heart. Well, if you play first and you get down a walkie-talkie, then I can play a card, which will give me the guns that you can play your card. And that's just like a normal part of the game. But then you got to watch while you're doing all this that you don't overrun a city with white hand tokens. So you're not just watching the resources.
I think this is part of why I really prefer the game with three players, because once you get up to more people, it just becomes chaotic. That part where you're trying to coordinate everyone's move, it just becomes a little bit too much.
Yeah, indeed. Acting brashly without consulting the team can be disastrous here, as the resources are all shared. So one wrong move can mean the difference between success and being overrun.
And Dan has already called it, right? The one problem with all of this collaboration and this puzzle is that with more players, it gets to be too much. Another aspect of it is all the players act before the game goes, right? That's a pretty standard. Many cooperative games, the player acts and the board goes. The player acts, the board goes. That's not that in this game. In this game, everyone goes and the board does. Well, remember that rule where if you place five white hand in a city, it becomes overrun? Well, five players, that's five people adding white hand tokens all over the board. Plus, the resource management's just harder. Like, yeah, there's tons of guns there at the start of your turn, but once four of the players go, you may not have the dice you need to be able to win that combat. The combos might be easier. Like, the combats are definitely easier, and getting clues is easier, right? You can have crates pop up all over the place with five players, but it doesn't matter if the cities are becoming overrun before you can get there or if you don't have the guns to be able to do the fights. After many plays, we said it already, the sweet spot, we think, is three players. I also found it very enjoyable with two. It's a very quick game with two, so I did enjoy that, and I'll play it with four. But I honestly, at this point, have no interest in ever playing the Art Project with five or six again.
No, at six, it's just an exercise in misery.
Yeah, I haven't tried it too, but even at four, I'm hesitant to play again. While three, experienced players, while far from guaranteed, will make a good run in a tight game that doesn't overstay its welcome at the table.
Now, on the opposite end of thing, you can play this game solo, and it plays ridiculously quick slow. Now, solo rules are simple. You play one character, and you pick another character to be an ally. You get three cards each turn. You have to play two, but you get to choose the order. Rest of the game is basically the same, except your ally can't fight on their own. They can collect artwork, and they do contribute a die when fighting with you. Overall, I dig the Art Project. I liked it well enough at five and six. I actually enjoyed it then when we first played it and thought there was a lot of neat things going on. But then I fell in love with it once we reduced that player count down to three. Honestly, it's quite a few games recently we played where the player count had a huge impact on my enjoyment of the game. At three players, this is one of the best games I own. And it's up there in my list of top cooperative games of all time.
Okay, this is 2 weeks in a row where I'm saying that I like a cooperative game. So I feel like I may have to turn in my I hate cooperative games card.
It was shocking because I didn't hate the game when I first played it at those higher player counts. Quite the opposite. But then when we played it at three, it just became elevated. It was the right player count to me.
So if you dig cooperative games, you're going to want to check out the Art Project. Again, it's the A.R.T, the A.R.T Project. Well, it features some familiar mechanics from games like Pandemic. There's enough other stuff going on that sets it apart. And one of the things that really sticks out to me is that dice-based combat system. If you like your, you know, rolling to hit style games, if you like that output randomness, that's actually in this game. And I think you'll dig that. That's something you don't see often in cooperative games.
If you want to work together to solve a puzzle, that's what's enjoyable here. If you look at it as a giant puzzle that you're trying to solve together with some randomness from dice and cards and whatever, but yeah.
And as Mo mentioned earlier, because of the hidden information on cards combined with the randomness of dice, it's just a little bit harder to have that quarterback problem you often see in cooperative games. Not impossible, but reduced.
Now, another group that I think will pick this up, because I know you're out there, hoarders and dragons who like to look at their hoards. If you collect great looking games, you're going to want this on yourself. Vincent Dutrait outdid himself with the art on this game.
Yeah, you could put these game boards on the wall in the house of any gamer and they wouldn't look out of place.
Yeah, it's so pretty. If you normally don't like cooperative games, I recommend you give the Art Project a try, especially at lower player counts. This one hits a little differently from most cooperative games, and it may just win you over.
Now, localizing the art project is actually part of a new initiative from the Op or USAopoly in an attempt to expand their strategy game offering, featuring games with a bit more meat on them than they usually produce. And to that end, I think they nailed it with the art project. Well, yeah, it might be a little heavier than what they usually offer. I think the feel of this game and the flow really fits with their catalog, and I can't wait to see what the Op has for us next.
That's it for our look at the Art Project, a clever cooperative game with fantastic production values and huge replayability through its 6 different scenarios. We ended up getting more than we expected from this one. What's a game that you've played that had way more content than you expected? Where you find stuff you usually find in expansions is right there in the original game box. Tell us all about it in the comments below.
Or head over to Tabletop Bellhop Discord and let us know there. And you can find us at discord.tabletopbellhop.com.